Good morning and welcome. Thank you for being with us this morning, whether you're in person or if you're joining us online. We're very glad you're here. Just a few things to mention this morning. One is that this is the first Sunday of the month, so we're having solemn Eucharist this evening at 5 p.m. Also, I want to mention to you that coming up over the coming few weeks, it's the beginning of May. Can you believe it? That means we're starting to look forward to some wonderful summertime activities, chances for us to gather together, including Pride in the CLE, which is happening on Saturday the 4th. If you'd like to participate and would like to order a shirt, I think you can reach out to Dan McGuire to do that. Also, we have a congregational picnic that'll be happening in June, and then we'll also be going to the Guardians game, I think in early July. So this is a historic moment. This is the first time Trinity has gone to see a Cleveland Guardians game. Right? Who doesn't want to miss that? That's right. So go ahead and start checking some of our channels. You can see in the bulletin today as well as online in order to see what some of the things that we're up to. Blessings to each of you and welcome.
is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, whose blessed Son made himself known to his disciples in the breaking of bread, open the eyes of our faith that we may behold him in all his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Saul, still breathing threats and murders against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogue at Damascus, so that if he found any who belonged to the way, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice but saw no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. So they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. For 3 days he was without sight and neither ate or drank. Now there was a disciple in Damascus named Ananias. The Lord said to him in a vision, "Ananias." He answered, "Here I am, Lord." The Lord said to him, "Get up and go to the street called Straight, and at the house of Judas, look for a man of Tarsus named Saul. At this moment he is praying, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him, so that he might regain his sight." But Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who invoke your name." But the Lord said to him, "Go, he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and before people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name." So Ananias went and entered the house. He laid his hands on Saul and said, "Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the way here, has sent me so that you might regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit." And immediately something like scales fell from his eyes, and his sight was restored. Then he got up and was baptized, and after taking some food, he regained his strength. For several days he was with the disciples in Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogues, saying, "He is the Son of God." Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
A reading from the Revelation to St. John the Divine. I looked, and I heard a voice of many angels surrounding the throne, and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, singing with full voice. Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom, and might and honor and glory and blessing. Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, to the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might and forever and forever. And the four living creatures said, Amen. And the elders fell down and worshiped. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Savior Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples, Simon Peter. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, we will go with you. They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, children, you have no fish, have you? They answered him, no. He said to them, cast the net to the right side of the boat and you will find some. So they cast it. And now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the nets full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore, full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and he did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of Judah, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter felt hurt because he had said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten a belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go." After this, he said to him, "Follow me." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
I have to start with a confession. I came terribly close to wearing Groucho Marx glasses in the pulpit this morning. You know the ones I'm talking about, right? The novelty glasses that come with a mustache and nose and plastic frames that if I happen to have a cigar handy to complete the look, you'd think either I was trying to be the life of the party or perhaps instead in disguise, wink, wink, wink. Of course, you've seen people wear these, right? Do you forget who they are? No, it's pretty obvious who the person is. I guess that's partly the gag. Well, in the Gospels, especially after the resurrection, Jesus often seems to be disguised, but very thinly disguised. Almost, I mean, we can tell who he is, but almost as if he's wearing those silly glasses and then in a moment takes it off and we say, "Oh, it's Jesus." But it's always at a certain moment. It's always at a certain moment. In fact, time and time again, people don't seem to notice that Jesus is standing right there in front of them. They're going about whatever they were going about before, focused on whatever there was going on in their lives, whatever was making them angry, whatever was getting their attention, or perhaps just walking through the grief and sadness that happened to be their life at that moment, and it was for many of them. Mary doesn't recognize Jesus at the tomb. Who does she think he is? The gardener. The disciples, time and time again, they don't realize who it is that they're talking to. I mean, how hard could it be? Until, of course, Jesus says or does something that connects with their hearts. They're all over the place. They're focusing on everything but what's right there in front of them. And then in the moment that they meet Jesus, Suddenly they are there. They are fully present and fully aware that Jesus is alive and with them. Cynthia Bourgeau is a mystic and an Episcopal priest who tells us that there is something to this pattern, that time and again in the Gospels, we see people meet Jesus for the first time, and that we should pay attention to that. She says the whole arc to the Gospels, not just in this season after Jesus has returned, but also really throughout the whole Gospel, are a series of what she calls recognition events, of people being surprised by Jesus. Now remember something. Unlike us, they don't know the story. None of these folks grew up with Sunday school or an Easter vigil or going on an Easter egg hunt. Can you imagine that? Wide gaps in their Christian formation, clearly. And yet, in the moment where they meet Jesus, something in them changes. Because when they see him, I mean, they really see him. And suddenly their hearts are warmed and their lives are changed. Think about it. Each of the stories, the fishermen mending their nets and meeting Jesus and following him because they see him and they recognize who he is. The centurion, the Syrophoenician woman, story after story are of people who don't know the story. And yet when they meet Jesus, something changes within them. Even Peter has these moments. He must like them so much, he keeps repeating them. He forgets them and has to recognize Jesus over and over again. In fact, in this story where Jesus says, "Do you love me? Feed my sheep, feed my lambs." A reminder that we forget and we have to return over and over again. To Cynthia Bourgeau's mind, we're actually limited by the fact that we know the story already. She calls it 20/20 hindsight. She says knowing all the stories can actually keep us from being surprised by those chance encounters with Jesus. She writes, all this knowing about Jesus can actually get in the way. It lulls us into a false sense of security that we're the winning team, that we'd recognize Jesus when he showed up. But even more problematically, it takes away from us the key tool that we need to find and live the path today. This tool is our own power of inner recognition. It's that moment when our defenses break down and suddenly, in the images of another person, we see the imprint of God, and we just know that the Holy Spirit is present. That's the basic DNA of most stories in the Gospels, where people suddenly have a heart-to-heart connection with Jesus that happens because they didn't expect it and they truly see him. This morning's readings are all about moments of recognition. First, Saul is blinded by a vision of Jesus. And by the way, we often talk about wanting to meet Jesus on the road. This was not a nice story. This was not a pleasant experience. This was a meet your maker kind of moment for Saul. And then in the Gospels today, the grieving disciples bring in a massive catch. And they realize that there's something special about the man who is standing right by the seaside. Something about the way he speaks to them. Something about how he calls them to the shore. Something about the way he prepares breakfast for them. They suddenly realize who it is. Their nets are full and they look up and Jesus removes the Groucho glasses. And they realize who it is. It's Jesus. And their hearts are full. But I want to go back to Paul. Because there really seem to be a few layers to his moment of recognition that really catch my attention. Paul's vision is not a simple moment where God shows up in a flash and says, "I have a job for you, write this down, go to it." No, Paul's vision takes days to unravel, and multiple players have to get involved. So that's it starts with Saul, who is not yet Paul, is on his way to Damascus. Let's remember the whole story. Saul had been present, if you will recall, for the very first martyrdom, for the stoning of Stephen. There Paul was at that moment. He was on the road now to Damascus because Saul was in Jerusalem, but it was beyond Jerusalem that the Jesus movement was really starting to take flight. And so learning about what's going on in Damascus, Saul hits the road to go and regulate, to put a stop to whatever it is that's catching fire. So Saul then has a vision on the road, but it's not a very pleasant experience, is it? First, we have to realize that Saul meeting Jesus meant confronting all those people that he had persecuted. There is no nice way to say this. Saul had blood on his hands. Sometimes meeting God means recognizing the harm that we have done to others along the way. Yet there is great power to change in this recognition event. Raj Nadella speaks of the profound ways in which people can be transformed when they acknowledge the pain and damage of forcing others to see the world as they do. The recognition event that happens in the mirror isn't always pretty. How not pretty is it? Well, if it's a true recognition event, don't expect that you're going to go straight to inner peace. I know we all want that, but that's not likely to happen. Cynthia Bourgeau writes, seeking leads to finding, yes, but the result is that finding, the result of that finding is often to plunge you into confusion and disorientation as the new information rattles the cage of your old paradigm. It often leads to confusion and disorientation as your old paradigm gets rattled. In other words, you might gain new sight, but you also might find yourself completely blinded. Who wants to sign up for that? But that is the path so often. And that's what happens to Saul. He has to stumble back to Jerusalem. Imagine this. Saul has to stand up and be led back to Jerusalem and then sit and wait, completely blinded, for someone else to show up at his door and tell him what's next. Now, what I know about Saul before this moment and what I know about Paul after this moment is I don't think he liked not being in control. I could be taking a guess at that one, but I'll bet sitting there for 3 days, not being able to see and having to wait on somebody else to come and tell him, he must have been going bananas. I borrowed that word from the Aramaic. But the person who shows up is who? Ananias. Now, Ananias, he really gets a straw in this story, doesn't he? I mean, he gets a vision too, but get this. He is supposed to go to Saul, who he knows perfectly well is the murderer of his fellow disciples. He's supposed to go to this person, really, and lay hands on him. So there's something quite layered here about what it means to be the body of Christ. And it's so layered, I couldn't begin to unpack it. I only know that there's a lot of mystery here and a lot being said about what it means to be bearers of a shared vision. God doesn't just show up in one vision. God shows up in a constellation of visions, a veritable film festival playing in different noggins all on the same night. A fragmented prophecy that only comes to pass if all the players somehow find one another, avoid the temptation to kill one another, and then finally see and recognize Jesus in one another. It sounds kind of like a long shot, doesn't it? But think about it. Think about all those times where you meet someone almost at random, and then if your heart is open, you might hear them say something that just unlocks something from your own life. I'm talking about when that person who you're meeting, who you never expected to meet, says something that only makes sense because of something you experienced 5, 10, 20 years ago. And you say to yourself, oh my goodness, there is something, they see something I don't see, or rather, they probably don't see it at all, but God sees it. There is something about this person. God has put this person in my path. Or maybe God has actually put me in front of this person's path, despite the fact that there may even be some mutual risk here. And yet something new is coming to pass because of it. We all each hold fragments of this grand vision that is God's. And it's only when we recognize one another, just as we recognize Jesus, that we fully follow it and live it out. So Ananias must have been a very faithful guy because he goes, right? He says what he does what God asks him to do. I came across someone's email signature this week that I loved. It was, I hadn't heard it, so I looked it up. Courage is fear that has said its prayers. So Ananias must have been afraid, and he must have also said his prayers because he goes. And he goes and he lays his hands on Paul, and yes, by doing that, it returns Paul's sight. The scales come off of his eyes, and he can see again. When have you descended into the kind of confusion and disorientation that Paul went through? Maybe you're there today. We all have those days, but think about a time in your life where that has been you. But maybe more importantly, who has been Ananias for you? A messenger, a bearer of God's dream, a carrier of another precious fragment of God's vision for the world. This is not just a moment or a series of mountaintop experiences. Bourgeau talks about recognition energy as our capacity to be surprised and changed by Jesus. And it is that capacity, it is that moment of recognition and change that fuels transformation. In the stories of Jesus, one person after another stumbles into a moment where they recognize the living God. By the way, pretty much nobody in the gospel ever encounters faith, I'm using big air quotes here, or takes a step on their faith journey. That's preacher talk, and I'll use it every Sunday, but you'll never find it actually in the gospel. Rather, what they do is they trip on faith. They bump their head on faith. They step in it, and they get it all over their shoes. And that's why it surprises them. That's why their hearts are changed. That's how Jesus becomes a living part of who they are. The disciples, through their tears, look up past their full nets and they realize who has been with them the whole time. They recognize him. It is the Lord, they proclaim. And then Jesus broke bread with them. And they knew that the one who is with them recognized them as well.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Risen Christ, you invited your disciples to touch you. We invite your touch today. Offer gentleness to those who have known harshness, and teach us how to touch one another with blessings from afar. By your grace, Prince of Peace, you gave peace to your disciples at their time of grief. Give peace to those today whose relationships are fragile, whose work is uncertain, and where violence is a constant fear or temptation. Speak peace to the places in our own lives that we keep hidden because we are at war with ourselves. By your grace, glorious Savior, even after your resurrection, your disciples were terrified at your appearance. In our fearful world, remind of us of our connection to one another, and reveal the anxieties that arise only from our own ignorance or prejudice. Deepen our joy and appreciation of every human life. By your grace, ascended Lord, even as the disciples celebrated your resurrection, they prepared for your departure. Give grace to those in the midst of difficult endings or departures. Help us when we know we need to let go in order to hold fast to the faith in your promises. We pray especially for the needs of this congregation: Pam, Brian, George, Malia, Debbie, Gary, Scott, Ward, Joyce, Bill, Lisa, Lori, Tem, Ruth Ann, Marty, George, Marianne, Jim, Nancy, David, Meredith, Tanya, Susan, Rich, and Crystal. We pray for our companions in the Diocese of Belize and in the Diocese of Tanga, Tanzania. In the diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for Church of the Redeemer, Lorraine, St. Paul's Church, Put-in Bay, Grace Church, Sandusky, and Old Trinity Church, Tiffin. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the churches in the Diocese of Leeds, England. We pray for our congregational ministries and volunteers who give their time to the lunch and supper group ministry. We pray for U.S. military personnel and for their families. We pray for a swift end to the war in Ukraine and for all those who are displaced, all who are in danger, and all who have died. We pray for loved ones who have recently died and for their families, especially Joanne Schofield. We pray for all those who've died from COVID and for their families. Prayers of thanksgiving for the ordination of Andy Lang in the United Church of Christ on Saturday, April 30th. We offer blessings upon those celebrating birthdays this week. Nell Bruckner, Paul Bunner, Bill Christ, Bess Connor, Stephen Emery, Phil Kovach, Becky Lissy, Sarah Scrocky, Terry Scrocky, and Mary Helen Wentz. And we pause to offer you our prayers for ourselves and for others, either silently or aloud. By your grace.
Christ of the empty tomb, who in your glorious resurrection appeared to your disciples locked away in fear, come to us as we are locked up by fear and breathe your renewing spirit. As your disciples in this day and age, make us ready to welcome the peace you bring, extend the peace you share, and go to where you send us. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be always with you.
Peace be with you. We don't see, we can't see you. You're on the spot. Peace be with you. Good morning. Hi, Gary. Nice to see you. Good morning and welcome. Peace be with you once again. If you're joining us for the first time, we welcome you. We're so glad you're here. If you're here in person, you can find newcomer information and cards at the base of any of the pillars. If you're joining us online, hope you'll get in touch with us so that we can follow up with you to get to know you just a little bit better. Welcome.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you. God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give Him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ.
By Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Please stand as you are able and join me in the post-communion prayer. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. May God bless you and keep you. May the light of the Holy Spirit shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the face of Christ turn toward you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
To love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.